thank you, all three speakers, for those excellent presentations. So, firstly, it's a bit of a delight to hear words like books and print and humanities and intermediaries being, or retail even, all the useful terms being mentioned in this conference, which tends to focus these days very strongly on journals and science and electronic. So, very useful to have that perspective. Also, very challenging presentation from Rick, one of the two Anderson brothers here today. He's put into words something that I've been trying to say to people for 10 years or so, which is, I've just never understood this idea of if you sort of need the journal, you'll pay for it, and if you sort of don't need it, then it should be free. I never kind of saw how that could possibly work, and I'm kind of with Rick in still not really seeing how subscriptions can stand up with Green OA. If only there was somebody in the audience, an expert on freemium, they might be able to speak up on that subject. But, I see Toby is in. We're going to do some questions in a moment. Just before we go to questions, and the microphone people will be milling about. And if microphone people, if you'd like to come forward a bit, you'll be able to see who's waving their arms, and they'll be able to see you. And then I'll point to whoever's going to have a question. Just quickly before we do that, on the Wi-Fi, I've heard a couple of people have had trouble getting onto Wi-Fi. I had some trouble too, to be honest. And the trick was to, if you've been here before, that may be the problem. The trick is to forget the network. However you do that with your system, and then kind of go back onto the network as if it's free as a visitor, and then you might well be able to connect at that time. That certainly worked for me, which has allowed us to watch the Twitter stream go by during the presentations, which has been nice. So, right, we're going to open up for questions, and the speakers have their radio mics. Hopefully they'll work and they'll be able to speak. So who's the first question? Kent Anderson there in the middle.
Mr. Anderson.
Well,
you said something that I could interpret in two ways, which is all the benefit of subscription without having to pay for it, which you put in the framework of green open access. But it made me think that's actually the experience of the people at your university as well. So as far as the faculty and the students, people who have the rights to access it through your network. So it seems that there's nobody whose user experience as a constituent of your university would be improved by the shift to Green OA.
Oh, no, well, they'd be dramatically improved because there's stuff to which they do not have free in their experience access now. I mean, certainly they have that experience in the case of the journals to which we subscribe. The problem is they don't have that experience in the context of the journals to which we don't subscribe. Until we achieve the great day of Universal Green OA, at which point they would have access to everything, or however close to everything we get.
Okay, thank you. Actually, a comment on that. So I was told a good story about library subscriptions where a university librarian found the vice chancellor marched into her office and said, I've just been reading a Harvard Business Review article saying that libraries are unimportant because subscriptions are unimportant. We don't need libraries to mediate subscriptions. And she said, well, yeah, but you were only able to read that article because the library subscribes to Harvard Business Review. And there is a problem of awareness, I think, in institutions of how this stuff is coming to them. And if the readers of material knew what was being paid or not paid for, they might have a different view.
And we struggle with that because on the one hand, we want our users' experience to be as transparent, as intuitive, and as easy as possible. On the other hand, to the degree that we succeed at that, we create this problem of awareness. And to the degree that we as librarians keep telling people that we provide free services, which is an absurd lie, we also contribute to that problem of awareness.
Is that working? I fear I'm returning to an old chestnut here, so forgive me. Rick, do you believe that publishers add any value? So in terms of curation, peer review, packaging, discoverability, and so on. And if you do, how does that get paid for in a Green OA world?
That's a really good question. I would say, yes, I do believe that publishers add value, and that's... We could argue all day about how much of what kinds of value do they offer or do they create. But as to your larger question, that's exactly the question. I mean, that's... I, think that one of the ways we have avoided engaging that question in a meaningful way is by saying, well, we don't have to worry about it because people aren't going to cancel their subscriptions just because they have access via Green OA. So the publishers will keep getting paid. As I said here, I'm not convinced that that's the case if Green OA succeeds the way it's trying to. If it does, I strongly suspect that publishers will stop getting paid, and at least some of them, and how many, depends on how successful that Green OA scenario is, will stop publishing. I mean, conceivably, at least some could end up going out of business. Now, there are some who would say, that's totally fine. We don't need publishers. We can do this ourselves without publishers doing what they've traditionally done, which, I mean, that's a proposition that I think it's entirely healthy to talk about. But let's not pretend that that's not what we're proposing.
Thank you. Daniel.
Hi, Ricky. As you can imagine, we're going to disagree on this. My name's Danny from Cambridge University. Just this issue about green, I think we need to be really clear about what we mean by green. Are we talking about green in terms of putting an author's accepted manuscript into a repository as opposed to a legal uploading into ResearchGate or Sci-Hub? Okay, if we're talking about that, it's a very, very small proportion. Michael Jubb's work himself that was published in August 2015 indicated that it's less than something like 5% of material is available through a repository. So I think we're kind of mixing stuff up here because librarians would need to be able to feel confident that there was enough of the material available to be able to make a cancellation. And if you are only relying on material that's sent through the AAMs into institutional repositories, well, good luck with that. I'm running one of the biggest universities in the world, our repository, and we have a full mandate from everywhere. We're lucky to get 50% of our material, so I'm not sure what you have to do to convince the researchers to give you their AAM. So the challenge I've got with the scenario you are creating of this utopia where suddenly people are producing AAMs, willingly and we've got 100% coverage, I just don't think it's realistic. But I do think we do need to be quite realistic about taking assessment of what the impact of this is going to be. We've had archives since 1991, so it's not new. So just creating a doomsday scenario and saying this can't happen, we need to not do it because of this potential threat. It's not really helpful. I think that we need to be having a conversation, and the information from publishers need to come through about if they are actually feeling any impact from all of this, because otherwise we're just speculating.
Right. And that's exactly why I propose sort of two different scenarios. I agree with you completely that under the scenario in which we're operating right now, the threat to subscriptions is very, very low. There's a spectrum between the scenario that I described and that you described as the one we're operating in now, and the one, again, towards which my impression is that the OA community is trying to move towards, and that is also, it's an extreme example, but it's the logical endpoint. So the question is, how close do we end up getting to the scenario in which functionally, everything is available freely on a Green OA basis? To the degree that we get there, there's a genuine, very large threat to subscriptions. Now, when I say threat, that's a negative-sounding word. Many of us in this room might think that would be wonderful. A scenario in which subscriptions are no longer sustainable, that's the world we're trying to work towards. It's not a subscription system anymore. It's just everything is free and open. But we are realistically going to end up somewhere between where we are today and what I proposed as the high cancellation scenario. How high or how close are we going to get to that, and what is it that we're trying to work towards? Are we accepting responsibility for the scenario towards which we're working? And if so, then we need to talk about what the implications of it are.
It does seem like there's a sort of logical fallacy which says that if Green OA works, then subscription must fail, and if Green OA fails, then subscriptions carry on, and neither of those seem very attractive to you.
Another question for Rick, I'm afraid. Really enjoyed your challenging presentation. Do you think you would like to be even more radical in pushing things along and in changing the market? So should all public funders of research adopt the Gates Foundation model or approach to academic publishing, and have the Gates refine their own strategy by cutting a deal with science, a very expensive deal as well?
So I'm not sure I understand the question. The question is...
Well, so should public funders of research require their authors to publish in fully open access journals? That would create a market for publishers who would then get paid for their services, but it would eventually then displace subscription publishing to a large degree.
They could do that. They're going to end up funding less research if in fact those funders allow authors to write APCs into their grant proposals. So the trade-off there, that's the trade-off that I think we have to talk about. And we may decide that trade-off is worthwhile. And of course, this only addresses publicly funded research as well.
That's true. In the UK, then, it's grants paid through HEFSI that can RFD pay for subscriptions.
Yeah, the UK is in the enviable situation of having a single system of public higher education. In the US, where we have upwards of 70, it's unfortunately a lot less possible to create any kind of generally applicable policy, whatever it might be. But certainly we see things like that happening in the UK and in European countries where they have centralized systems of higher education.
Okay, ideally I'd like to take a question on intermediation, big books, retailing, those kind of things. So if you've got one of those, Kent, and then Anthony at the back there, please.
I've been saving a books question. So the moving toward e-books is going very slowly, correct? In fact, maybe not at all anymore. It might have reached a point and maybe sagging. I've been doing a lot of reading, and I just had to review a book, and I was sent a print copy. And a lot of reading about how the uptake of information through via print, via physical artifacts is faster, better, easier, retention is better, so on and so forth. I just had to review a book. I was sent a print copy, and marking in it, interacting with the ideas, dog-earing pages, being able to return back and forth, knowing spatially where I was. Is there just an inherent, in your opinion, superiority to a physical artifact for people who are engaged in high-end intellectual work rather than just a scroll that just keeps going?
I think all I can say is that all the survey evidence, and there's been quite a lot of survey work done in the UK and also in the US, shows a very strong preference for print, both on the part of academic staff and on the part of students. So it's not simply a generational issue. And indeed, the most recent Ithaca survey actually showed an increase in the preference for print as against the e. Now, of course, it could be the case that some unforeseen change in the technology will mean that the attitudes and behaviours and so on will flip in ways that we can't foresee at the moment. But without that, it seems to me that it is very unlikely that if publishers are to continue to meet the preferences of their readers, they will be able to abandon print.
So, next question. There was a couple of people at the back, somebody right at the back, and I think Anthony nearly at the back there.
Anthony Watkins, Cyber Research. I wasn't going to ask a question, actually, but I was responding to your cry from the pulpit. But I wanted to ask Michael, particularly, and also Richard, about what they thought about the Charlotte Initiative, which, as I understand it, is trying to put forward a model which is different from the aggregated model, which enables libraries, one, to own e-books, and two, to have no DRM. And there's a third, which Michael will know, but I've forgotten.
I think that there is a long way to go before the current experimentation in acquisition models in libraries, which Rick knows far more about than I do, has run its course. I, th- think that there are very real problems for libraries in the current acquisition models, which are highly complex. They come with all these variations in the platforms that I've mentioned, as well as differences in the usage that is allowed under the various different licensing models. So I don't have a crystal ball as to how this is going to work out in the future. What I can say is that I think there is pretty common consent across all the key agents in the system, from libraries through the aggregators back up to publishers. No one thinks that the current system is anything like optimal.
I think to add to that for Anthony, I think it's important again to stress the weird internationalism of the book landscape in this context. I mean, there are no dominant, there's nothing quite as dominant as certain pockets of activity in science where you can say, this is how it's going to be, this is what's going to happen next. Partly for the language reasons I mentioned, and it's very important to remember, there are major monographic linguistic traditions in French, Italian, German, Spanish, Asian languages, etc., still very, very much active. It's not the same, and that's one of the ways why in which, not least the libraries, particularly major research libraries with international collections, the real challenges around this stuff, and the lack of any kind of dominant models at the moment. The AAUP and its members tends to get most of the coverage, but it's worth saying, as the stats released on the kitchen last week, the AUP is a relatively small part of overall monographic outputs in the Western world, a very small part. You know, you have to look again, and the people I always think are massively under-articulated in this are the likes of Bloomsbury, TNF, Palgrave, the commercial monographic sector, which is still huge, particularly in Europe, and always under-articulated in these kind of conversations.
Okay, thank you. We'll just take the last question right at the back there.
Thank you, Michael and Richard, for sketching out the complexity of the supply chain. The question is now what? Looking at those history publishers you mentioned, what would you recommend a reasonable big publisher how he gets rid of the other 200 facing that complexity? And the other way around, what was the 251st publisher? What would you recommend to do so he doesn't get lost facing this complexity?
Again, I'm extremely hesitant to tell any publisher what they should do. But I do think that for the larger publishers, there is much more mileage with the right level of investment in building direct relationships, particularly with libraries, but also with e-commerce systems for the retail trade. That implies, of course, much better discoverability. It's very difficult to find out if you're interested in some aspect of medieval history in Europe, say, and you want to find out about the latest publications that may be of interest to you. It's absurdly difficult to do that on publishers' sites at the moment. For the smaller publishers, I think that intermediaries are going to remain very important for some time to come. Simply because they don't have the scale to attract users and potential users to their own platforms, and so they're reliant on intermediaries to do some of the business for them. But I'm sure Richard has more to say on that.
The smaller history publishers, who of course will be things like the Linkage Record Society, you know, it's at that level that we're talking for some of these institutions with tiny levels of capitalization, very largely run by volunteer labor, but often with very high scholarly standards. And I mean, to answer the question, I suspect this diversity, this polarity will survive for many, many years to come. There's actually no incentive, nobody's going to bring up these small, often defiantly independent, volunteer-based, but serious operations. So, you know, your guess is as good as mine. But I think particularly it's worth emphasizing the community, and historians I know best, but for literature people, political scientists, whatever, that diversity is absolutely something to be celebrated, not the opposite, even in the consequences, as Michael has hinted at, in terms of overall access to the research are not always entirely those which you might wish.
Okay, thank you. Right, we're going to break for lunch now. Thank you very much. We break for lunch. Today's lunch is sponsored by my own company, Mosaic. I hope you enjoy the lunch. Can we be back here at 1:50, 5 to 2, for the next session? Can you just join me in thanking our three excellent speakers? Thank you very much.